Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. A very hearty welcome to the INMEX SMM webinar on COVID-19 impact on maritime, for which the Indian Ministry of Shipping, as known as IR Class, are our knowledge partners. A very special welcome to all the very distinguished speakers, Sri Amitabh Kumar, Director General of Shipping and the Additional Secretary to the Government of India, Dr. Sujata Nayak, the Chairperson of Kulani Shipping, Mr. Vijay Arora, the Joint Managing Director of Indian Ministry of Shipping, and Captain Sanjeev Sharma, the Managing Director of Bernard Tute Ship Management India. At the outset, I would request by Mr. Jogesh Mudra, the Managing Director of Informa Markets, which owns this INMEX SMM brand, to give his welcome speech. Very short introduction to Mr. Mudraj. He's a very professionally qualified person. He's a chartered accountant, certified personal accountant. He is also a law graduate. He has done management. And above all, I may say with some pleasure, he is the son of one of my ex-colleagues in Shipping Corporation of India. So over to Jogesh Mudraj.
Good afternoon, and thanks a lot for it's a pleasure to get introduced by Ajara. I had an opportunity of working under him in Shipping Corporation. So I come myself from shipping industry, having worked in the industry for 9 years, 6-7 years of that, where is Shipping Corporation India itself. So again, welcome you all to on behalf of Info Markets in India and organizers of INMEX and SMM, the leading maritime show in India. Great pleasure to launch this webinar series on COVID 19 impact on the maritime sector and the industry's expectations. This is what we are going to be discussing here today. This is in partnership with Indian Register of Shipping, knowledge partners, and a warm welcome to all the eminent speakers from both the government and private sector. A warm welcome to Shri Amitabh Kumar, IRS Director General of Shipping. I'm sure he's joining shortly. I think he's facing some connection problem. He should be on immediately soon, very soon. Mr. Vijay Arora, Joint Managing Director, Indian Register of Shipping, Dr. Sujata Nayak, Chairperson, Tolani Shipping Company Limited, Captain Sanjeev Sharma, Managing Director, Bernard Schult, Ship Management India Private Limited, and of course, Shri Sabyasachi Hajra, former Chairman and Managing Director, Shipping Corporation of India, who will be moderating the panel sessions, which are going to take place. Just a brief introduction of Informa Markets in India and the Informa Markets group, as well as the Informa PLC. Informa Markets in India is a part of the Informa PLC, which is London listed entity, and which are we are one of the largest information services group in the world. We are, in fact, the Informa Markets division is the exhibition division, and as a part of exhibitions, we are the largest B2B events organizer in the world, organizing over 500 trade shows globally in 40 plus countries. In India, we are doing 26 plus trade shows, plus 40 odd conferences, and plus we have business intelligence team and 100 plus colleagues in four cities in India. Coming to the marine sector, we have some of the leading brands across the world. As you know, for the INMEX exhibition series, which we do here with the Hamburg Messe team. We also have the Sea Trade exhibition series. We do the Marine Tech show in China.
I got a call from you.
We have the TOC container exhibition series. We also do the cruise shipping shows in Singapore and Miami.
Yeah, I'm just trying to look at also, his name. What name has he logged in as?
We have the intelligence team for the Lloyd's List. So you know us by all these brands, which
that's very maritime sector. PG Shipping Mumbai, na?
The global slowdown, along with the COVID-19 pandemic, if you see, has no doubt been challenging for the shipping industry. With decline in trade,
freight,
severe supply chain disruptions, and additional costs due to stringent. As we see, the new buzzwords are social distancing and digitization. The government has recently come out with the relief packages, and we have seen across industries. But the jury is out that they probably are more long-term in nature, the impact of which will be seen over the next 3 to 5 years.
Only
a portion of it is for the immediate term. But it will be great to see what the panelists discuss here today. Eminent panel,
an option of
some of the key areas on managing the operational challenges which are faced by this industry,
the impact on regulatory aspects.
The medium and long-term impact of the maritime sector, seafarers' challenges, and whether the pandemic will accelerate digitalization and technology adoption. The only silver lining in this crisis could be the post-pandemic, we could see the evolution of new trade standards and certifications, new value chains pick up, connecting countries over digital platforms and paperless trade. Countries will also seek faster, cleaner transportation, including instead of just the ordinary FTAs. So look forward to a very engaging session to throw light on some of these issues. Thanking again our leading experts who have joined us here today and all you committed audience of industry professionals who have joined us here for this webinar. So thank you, sir, and over to you, Mr. Hajra, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Yogesh, for your welcome speech. As the moderator, my responsibility is to just give a very, very short introduction to the topic and then introduce the speakers one by one. First, as far as the topic is concerned, I am sure all of us and all our viewers, we have been only hearing about COVID-19 for the last so many months. So we know all about it, but at the same time, I must say that anyone who talks of post-COVID, I think that's a complete misnomer. Because in my humble opinion, the COVID is here to stay. It means obviously it will not stay in the pandemic form. But then I don't think the COVID is going to go away. At the same time, we don't even know how it will pan out. So the impact can never be assessed in that sense. But obviously, we have to go on different scenarios. As far as shipping is concerned, shipping and maritime is concerned, I think since this is a maritime forum, I would first like to give my own humble salutation to all the Indian as well as global seafarers. I think they are the unsung heroes for the mankind's fight against this COVID-19. I know we owe a large debt of gratitude to all the frontline workers, like the medical, paramedical professionals, the government municipal workers, the police, the military, the banking industry people, the logistics front chain workers, all of them. But I would still like to single out seafarers because they have been working for months at a stretch, being thousands of miles away from their home and family, without many times knowing properly how their loved one backs at home are coping with these very challenging times. So my special salutation to them. As far as shipping and maritime is concerned, as we all know, shipping and maritime is a secondary industry. The demand for shipping is a derived demand, which totally depends on the economy and the trade. There are predictions that the world GDP will go down by $5.8 to $8.8 trillion. These are all estimates, the estimates you can say. So this means since our world GDP is close to about $95 trillion or thereabouts, there could be a retraction by anywhere between 5, 8 or 10% of the world GDP in this 2020. The trade, which is well over 11 billion tons, something like 55, 60 billion ton miles, that could contract again anywhere between 5 to 10 to 15%. So obviously the impact on shipping is going to be huge. At the moment, the container rates have really come down despite hundreds of blank sailing, despite the capacity being restrained by the container carriers, still the container rates have come down. The bulk carrier rates also have crashed. The Cape size is earning today just between $4,000 to $4,500, which is not even meeting their OPEX. Tanker rates, surprisingly, of course, is still quite firm. It had gone through the roof because of the storage situation. Now it has corrected, but still tanker rates are still pretty good. But in my opinion, I don't think this boom will be long-lived because the oil consumption from 100 million barrels per day is projected to come down to barely 90 million barrels at best in this year. Of course, the next year it is supposed to somewhat improve. So in the long term, the tanker market, and obviously because the oil price again has crashed, it had gone down to below $20 per barrel for Brent. Now it has recovered and I think it is in somewhere in the mid-30s. So because of the oil price crash, even the offshore market is supposed to be impacted very, very adversely. Anyway, since we have so many very, very distinguished speakers, I'll not come between them and you all viewers. My great pleasure and privilege to introduce our first speaker, none other than Sri Amitabh Kumar, the Director General of Shipping and the Additional Secretary of the Government of India. Let me give a short introduction. He is a 1987 batch IRS officer who served the Ministry of Finance with real distinction and won many awards and accolades during his tenure as principal commissioners and other posts. So it has been the gain of the maritime industry, and I would say the loss of the finance ministry in having him with us. He has done a great job in the shipping department also, particularly his emphasis on the e-governance and digitalization has been a tremendous help, I would say, to the entire industry. And during this COVID period, it has been him who has really worked so diligently, so sincerely with the MHA to have those SOPs in place so that our seafarer friends could again start getting back home. So I think all in the shipping industry, we owe a large debt of gratitude to him. He is, of course, a brilliant person. He has done management in Australia, management in USA, including the very prestigious school, Wharton School of Business Management. So I have this pleasure and privilege to welcome him. And over to you, Sri Amitabh Kumar.
Thank you so much, Mr. Hazra. It was a very brilliant speech, brilliant introduction to the issues that we are facing today. You're very right when you said that there is no post-COVID. It is how do we manage shipping in COVID situation. There will be post-lockdown, but COVID is not going anywhere anytime soon. So the entire discussion should be as to how do we manage shipping with the COVID situation in mind. Dr. Sujata Naik Tolani will discuss in detail the coronavirus and its characteristics. That is her expertise, and I will not delve too much into how coronavirus is impacting us as a society, as a family, as a society, as a trade, as a government. But what has distinguished coronavirus with other viruses is the fact that the carrier of this virus does not know that he is a potential carrier. And anyone who is interacting with you is a potential carrier. So everyone is a suspect in your mind. With this huge constraint that has now been created because of coronavirus, the shipping industry has to now reorient its entire processes. The biggest impact for coronavirus, especially in the immediate term, is on the seafarers on board or those who intend to go on board to earn their livelihood. The seafarers have been impacted in two different ways. One, their operational challenges on board has increased manifold because of the precautions that they need to take, the hygiene that they need to maintain, the disinfecting activities that needs to be carried out, the constraints that have been created by the ports on the ships and the seafarers. Each and every constraint that we put on a ship is actually passed on to the seafarer on board to manage. So most of the ports are not allowing any crew change. Most of the ports are not allowing these people to come down off the vessel. They are not accepting garbage or any other activities. Ration is limited in many countries, so getting provisions is not as easy as it was earlier. And with these constraints, they have to manage the additional workload on board. But what is really affecting them mentally is the constraint that has been put on sign-on and sign-off. We have started in a small way in the sense that sign-on and sign-off has been allowed for seafarers on Indian ports. But we all know that very few foreign flagships come on Indian port. And it is not possible for those who are working on foreign flagships to utilize the facilities that have been provided on Indian port. So the whole question comes down to their ability to travel. When would they be allowed to travel from a foreign country to India, Indian airports, so that they actually manage to sign off from the vessel and come to their families. Even when they come to the family, those who are coming to the families have to face quarantine either in their own house or in a institutionalized quarantine facility. So it is not easy for them even when they come off the vessel. And all of this is weighing heavily on their minds. It is important that as a maritime industry, we manage their expectations. Unless and until we manage their expectations as an industry, we will be doing a great disfavor to these seafarers by raising their hopes, by misrepresenting the ground realities to them, by showing them that life is going on as usual outside of the ship environment, and by somehow telling them or conveying to them that once they get off the ship, it will be life as usual for them. We need to realize that coronavirus has impacted not only the shipping industry. In fact, I have said this in another forum that shipping industry maybe one of the least affected industry because of coronavirus. When I see the plight of the trade, and I receive at least 1,000 emails every day from the Exim trade. Their factories are closed. Their labor is migrating. Their papers are stuck in posts somewhere. They are not in a position to accept their present contracts. They are not in a position to enter into any future contract. And this is true of almost entire manufacturing activities all over the world. We are least impacted because at least we are functional. We may be functional at 60% of our capacity or 70% of our capacity, but at least some activity is going on. But I agree that if we talk of the convention requirement, the MLC requirement, maybe we are not in a position to fulfill each and every rights of a seafarer as of today. But we are not in a position to fulfill each and every right enshrined in the Constitution for each and every citizen of the country. I think this is in the first time in our memory where each and every citizen has been put under house arrest for so long. This is not what the Constitution had thought of as individual rights. So individual rights have been curtailed because the world did not know how to manage a situation like this. Slowly, we are learning to manage the situation. Slowly, we are realizing that we cannot contain the virus. We need to learn to live with it. We need to learn and accept that some of us will get infected in the course of our business or in the course of our day-to-day activities. And we need to plan our affairs now, given the constraint that we have landed ourselves in. The same situation is there with ships, and I would not like to repeat. I am sure many panelists will say, what are the constraints in managing the certificates of the vessels? What are the constraints in surveys and inspections and audits? What are the constraints being faced by new ship construction activities? We are hearing a lot of constraints that the ship recycling industry is facing. They are not able to accept any new vessel because most of these vessels have foreign crew on board, and they just don't know what to do with the foreign crew in the present circumstances, where the country has banned receiving any foreign nationals on Indian soil. But one thing is clear, that we now need to rethink not only the technology, we need to rethink of the processes, we need to rethink of the requirements that are the statutory requirements, regulatory requirements that are on board, and see how best we can manage shipping with this constraint. And I would say that we need to have a relook at each and every convention that have been put in place today. You think of one convention and it has got affected, impacted because of coronavirus. And if we have to adhere to each and every convention requirement, which we should, because ultimately it impacts the safety of life and property at sea, then we need to think of coming around to full compliance, keeping in view the technology that is available, the technology that can be brought in, the self-certification and self-audits that can be introduced. And that is how we need to manage the situation in next 1 year or so. I was talking to my son, who is a machine learning scientist. And his expertise is in speech technology. And he was saying that, see, all the electronics that we have introduced in the industry, even in the shipping industry, is all touch-based technology. Whereas we have enough technology in place to remove the concept of touch also from electronics. And speech is one technology which needs to be introduced immediately in managing electronics in our day-to-day life. We have started using speech for listening to music or listening to news, but very few industrial use has started using speech as a technology. If we start using speech as a technology, then maybe all our navigational requirements, all our engineering requirements, the requirements of pilots on board can be managed using speech. We also need to see whether we need to have pilots on board. If we don't have pilots on board and the pilotage is done through a remote location, maybe a escorting vessel or a remote location, then many of the problems that we face today of safety on ship, even otherwise, or of boarding of a ship by a person on shore can be reduced. We need to have a complete relook at our cargo operations, both at ships and on port needs to be automated so that there is no requirement of a human interaction for cargo operations when the ship comes to the port. All the port related activities can easily be done through a remote location. When a ship can transit in the sea without any human intervention, there is no need for human intervention when it comes to the port. Only we need to rethink our processes and maybe utilize some technology for that purpose. From trade side, we were quite shocked to know that even today, a lot of paperwork is required for cargo operations, for taking delivery of the cargo. And in such situation, where movement from one place to another is so restricted, these are the easy pickings where we think of revised processes, where all these paper requirements for both ship operation, cargo operation, and our trade requirements is completely done away with. There is in today's day and world, there is absolutely no reason as to why any of our transaction requires any paperwork on any side. And especially in shipping and airline industry, this paperwork is completely uncalled for. So we need to look into that also. There are many small things. I would not like to get into those details. But as I said, each and every convention that we are following today needs a relook, and needs a relook very soon, so that our shipping activity is resumed as soon as possible. We have issues relating to educational institutions, relating to opening of offices, relating to transportation of seafarers. Those issues will soon be resolved. Those are the issues that I always say it relates more to the lockdown than to coronavirus. Lockdown is not going to be permanent, it is going to be temporary. So whatever relief we can give to our seafarers during the lockdown is an added bonus. But what we need to really rethink is the way we have to conduct business with coronavirus constraint. And I think today's webinar should be the right place to start putting SOPs and processes in place to deal with coronavirus situation for each and every constraints that we are facing in the shipping industry today. And we should keep at least 2 years time frame in mind if we feel that we need to operate at 100% capacity in this situation also. So all the best to the panelists, and I hope we will hear a lot of questions and a lot of suggestions. And I'm sure we would be in a position to incorporate a number of suggestions in the SOPs that we will have to finalize in days to come. Thank you. Thanks for giving.
Thank you very much, Amitabhji. As usual, you have been very, very lucid, very informative. I can't agree with you anymore that there is nothing going to be so-called business as usual or as normal going forward. The entire world will be a changed place. Normal will also be all new normal. As regards the impact on shipping, of course, fortunately, primarily thanks to the seafarers, yes, shipping has remained functional. But, you know, in April, just from India, the exports had fallen by 60%. So obviously, the container carriers had to cancel sailings after sailings. So shipping, as I said, is a derived demand. It has been impacted badly, and it's going to be continued to be impacted badly for the reasons you mentioned for which the trade will be. As far as, of course, the ship recycling industry, we do appreciate their problems. I am sure ship building also being a very labor-intensive industry must be also having their own challenges. Having said that, I don't think it is difficult to say, because it is now completely all over the world, that there is a so-called anti-China sentiments all over the globe. So whether even in shipbuilding, India can get at least slight advantage out of that. One has to see, and one has to really, you know, try to exploit that. Your concept, which has come from your son, about this speech-based technology rather than touch-based technology, is really fantastic. I think that is the way to go forward. And digitalization will definitely get a boost out of this COVID-19. And if not autonomous, at least I'm sure semi-autonomous ships will be a reality not too long a distant in future. Anyway, I'll not take more time. I would now request Dr. Jyota Nayak, after having introduced her, to deliver her speech. Dr. Jyota Nayak is the chairperson of Pilani Shipping. He is, of course, a very, very qualified medical professional who I believe went up to be the director of the intensive care unit of Brooklyn Hospital in New York. But again, in her case, the loss to the medical profession has been the gain for the shipping industry. And I cannot but mention that she is the daughter of Dr. N.P. Pilani, the shipping luminary, who, in my opinion, has done the maximum for the education system and education industry, education facilities in the country. There are many shipping luminaries, but what Dr. Pilani has done for education per se in our country is absolutely phenomenal. So Dr. Pilani, I think at his request, Jyota came away from USA and took over the Pilani Shipping, and I'm sure she is guiding her company to greater heights. I will now request Dr. Sujata and I to deliver it.
May I start now?
Please start.
Yeah, and am I heard well enough?
Absolutely, loud and clear.
Okay, wonderful. So at the start, I would like to thank you, Mr. Hajra, for those very kind words. Sorry, and I especially thank you for remembering my father at this time. Clearly, he was, you know, a very important piece in all of this of Tolani Shipping. So thank you for remembering him. Thank you also to Mr. Amitabh Kumar for your kind words earlier. I'm sorry. I'm going to share my screen now with everybody. And I need to, who's disabled part? I think my screen sharing has been disabled. I think the host needs to
is Madhur, enable me. Madhur around? Madhur?
Now
If you want, ma'am, I can. Screen sharing is possible. You need to go down and there's a share screen option.
Can you put up the screen?
Can you put up the screen?
No. It has been disabled. My sharing screen has been disabled by the host.
Ma'am, check now. Now it would be possible.
Share your presentation with the machine.
Okay, now we're good. Okay, we're good now. We're good now. Okay, is everybody able to see?
Yes.
Okay, great. So a note of thank you to Informa Markets, Hamburg Mess and Congress, INMEX, SNM, and IRS. We at the Tolanis are a small drop in the ocean, and therefore thank you for this honor. And the opportunity to share our thoughts and experience. A very good afternoon to all present here, with a special good afternoon to all the attendees. It is because of you all that we are able to host and be a part of this discussion. Just on this no handshaking, I couldn't find one which said COVID pandemic, so I had to use the flu season. I'm really surprised that somebody will lagging behind in this. By now, there should have been one which said COVID pandemic. So a little bit about COVID-19, and I think Mr. Amitabh Kumar has given me the liberty to talk a little bit about COVID-19 itself. In life, there are a few life-changing periods of events that occur. And in my lifetime, I think up till now, I have seen two very life-changing events or periods, if I may say. The 9/11 and 26/11, these were really life-changing. We lived a life very differently prior to this. And so much changed after that. And now, despite the best of securities, we are living in the aftermath of these, not knowing when the next terrorist attack will happen. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm blocking my own screen with this. I need to figure this out. Okay. Yeah, got it. The second, or I should say previous to this life-changing period that my lifetime went through, was when HIV came in and we had the HIV and AIDS era. But thanks to the extent of research done, we now know what precautions to take, and there are medications to keep an HIV infection from becoming a full-blown AIDS. And now we have COVID-19. As has been mentioned, COVID-19 is here to stay, and make no mistake of this. But hopefully, this is until we have an effective vaccine. Now, even if the vaccine does come in, whether it is going to be 100% effective all the time, I don't know about that, because the flu vaccines are not 100% effective. And there should be effective treatment. True, that will help, but sometimes in these severe cases, it is not going to save us from the worst. And then, is it possible that it may just simply vanish? And this is on a lighter note, because if you look at the book by Sylvia Brown, End of Days, published in 2016, she actually talked about the severe pneumonia-like illness, and then said, more baffling than anything else. Maybe it might just suddenly vanish as quickly as it arrived, attack again 10 years later, and then completely disappear. Now, this I would say is wishful thinking. So what is making COVID-19 the bane of our existence? And for how long? As Mr. Amitabh Kumar said, it is the hidden enemy. Those who have it don't come with it written on their forehead. It is highly contagious. Where it is said that tuberculosis, you need to spend a full day with a person to maybe get it. In COVID-19, all you require is 30 minutes and you could catch COVID-19 from somebody. No one is immune and not enough is known yet. If I get COVID-19 once, am I going to not get it again? We don't have answers for this. We have significant morbidity and mortality. But remember, whatever the mortality rate be and how low it may be, if it happens to you, it is 100% for you. So COVID-19 and maritime. As again, Mr. Amitabh Kumar said, many businesses have come to a standstill. The merchant navy continues to serve 90% of the global trade. Yes, there is depressed earnings and maybe not serving at 100% capacity, but it still does. And why is this possible? Because of the 1.2 million seafarers who are standing tall in the midst of this global crisis. And more importantly, or equally important, it is because most of our vessels are still COVID-19 free. So what is the bottom line? Have robust systems in place to protect human lives and to continue global trade. So if I look at with this little picture where it says 5 minutes in hand, it is impossible to cover all these talking points. I will limit myself to areas that we have had experiences with and the messages that I would like to leave you all with. As mentioned earlier, the administration and also the ministry have been so active and played such a dedicated role, which is including but not limited to identifying shipping industry as an essential service and the human resources for the industry as key workers, setting up SOPs specially related to crew change, evacuation of stranded seafarers, and many others. What is good is that at all points and times, they have taken inputs from the industry. We have gone back and forth before things were etched in stone, and still never anything is etched in stone because this whole thing has been so dynamic that we keep going back to the drawing board and doing it better each time. So immense gratitude to the ministry and to administration for this. So managing operational challenges. In early March 2020, we had a vessel planned for special survey dry dock in China. Vessel was already positioned to undergo dry dock. We obviously fled from there because we didn't want to have anything to do with China at that point. We took up another employment.
I'm on an OEB now. I'm the moderator.
We had to take up another employment. We sailed away. And only when we figured that things were better did we come back. And in this time, we toyed with the idea of going other places for dry dock. But the challenge was that since this was ballast water plant time for us to be putting it on board, we had already got our ballast water treatment plant into China. So there was no way we could go somewhere else to do our special survey. I mean, we could have, but it would have been a big challenge. However, by the end of March, we were able to come back and go into dry dock and very successfully complete our special survey. What was interesting is that we also wanted to get a superintendent from the office there. And China made good arrangements to make this happen. We had to allow our superintendent to be put through 14 days of quarantine prior to releasing him to the yard. But he was well taken care of in those 14 days of quarantine, and he could continue work from his quarantine room. That's how we managed that dry dock. Clearly, extensions of certificates was required. A lot of effort was put in from, you know, the administration to make sure that we are on track on this. But even at the IMO level, I understand today there is no legal framework for extensions beyond all possible extensions. What became a real challenge was supply of stores and spare parts. Movement of all these were limited. We couldn't get them from point A to point B. The cost factor became a burden. And even if it came to port or to that particular city, delivery at the port was again a little bit of a nightmare. Services. Who doesn't need services at ports? Something going wrong on the vessel, you need shore help, was not going to be easily available. And above all of this, from every port contact that our seafarers were going to deal with, there was a risk of infection. We had to put in protocols to ensure how we could minimize the risk completely so that our seafarers remain safe despite port contacts. What we're still toying with is medical emergencies while at port or at sea. How are we going to deal with them? It could happen anytime. Where are we going to land our seafarers? Are we going to be able to airlift? Where will they go? These are still questions that we need to answer. Coming to crew changes. Yes, they need to be done because contract periods are up. Fatigue can set in. There are mental health issues. People could be concerned about their own health, concerned about families' health, how families are managing. And for those ashore, financial pressures on them because they are not employed. All of these are problems. However, in the face of these problems, I think for the most part, and I must salute our seafarers, they have stood tall and they are allowing themselves to go along with the tide to see when the moment is right. Because at the end of the day, everybody understands that the most important priority is ensuring that our vessels are free of COVID. Crew chain challenges are, I look at it in two parts. One is the challenge of moving from point A to point B in the face of the logistic challenges of no air travel, no trains. When do they need to do this, our seafarers? For medical exam, for going from home to port, going from port to home, and for COVID testing. SOPs have been put into place for this. And as long as there is lockdown, we will have these issues. There could be challenges. But when lockdown is removed, some of these things will improve. But to me, the larger challenge is to execute this movement in the face of COVID-19 lurking as the hidden enemy. How do we ensure? So most bodies today are very concerned and are ensuring no transfer of COVID-19 from land to land or sea to land. We have a peculiar problem to ensure that there is no transfer of COVID from land to sea. In the ideal world, from what we hear today, it would be great to be able to have a 14-day quarantine prior to our vessel, to boarding our vessels. But this is practically not possible for multiple reasons. One biggest reason which we know in our industry is our dates of vessels arriving, leaving, are so fluid till the last minute, we may not be able to every time pin down our employment, our next port of call. So these lead us with problems as to, okay, where are we going to do this 14-day quarantine near a port? Also, there are clearly challenges with respect to how much time it's going to take, how much it's going to cost. What was very pleasing to see, now IMO has come up with their recent recommendation for ensuring safe ship crew changes and travel during the COVID-19 pandemic. And I would urge everybody who has anything to do with crew changes or anything to do with the shipping industry, you work in offices where crew change is happening, is to go through this document. It's very extensive, but it is spelling out the way of life for all of us. They have divided it into 12, P6, P1 to P6 and P7 to P12, referring to sign-on and sign-offs. And the part that they have introduced, which I am pleased to have there and hopefully be able to expand on this for everyone, for, you know, our crew changes, is their 6.1 clause, where they refer to the time spent on board a ship after embarkation. And what is their objective? This is to monitor the health of seafarers following embarkation and to manage and control the risk of infection other seafarers on board should the seafarer have become infected, the one who has just joined, while traveling to join the ship, and this was not detected prior to the time of embarkation. COVID-19 testing has false negatives. There's incubation periods that they may not pick up. It is technology dependent, technician dependent, that they may not pick up. And so even after the persons have joined the vessels, this time on board, if we keep it at maybe 14 days, would really help save other seafarers from becoming infected if in the remote event that somebody is put on board with COVID-19. Coming to digitalization and technology adoption, we must all upgrade our IT systems. It has become so clear that for us who have survived through all of this, we have been able to do this only because of our IT systems. Do we need better hardware? Do we need better storage capacity? Do we need to go in cloud? Do we need to have better internet connectivity? All this must be looked at, because eventually what we need to do is become paperless. As DG said earlier, this is really, really important for us. I will tell you that the hospitals in the US, most of them today, do not use a piece of paper at all. Everything is on the computer, everything. So if they can do it, so can we in our shipping industry. And I would urge that we endeavor deeply to get to this point. Virtual meetings. Yeah, why do we need to travel anymore for meetings when we can sit in our own office, sit in our own place and do it? I think this is so important to be, I think there'll be so much saving of time. There may be some things where we need to go and we need that personal contact, but for the most part, we don't need to travel, you know, places. We don't need to go from one place to another, to another city. We must get into this mode of doing virtual meetings more often. And of course, contactless port calls. When we are able to get everything else in order, eventually, as DG also brought up some points, I think we will be able to get to a point of contactless port calls. You know, they say necessity is the mother of invention. I think as much as bad COVID-19 has done, it is going to put us ahead by several years in the way that we need to live and operate. Medium and long-term impact. DG rightly said that the short-term impact has been probably seen least by the shipping industry compared to all other businesses. But where are we going to be on the medium and long-term? It is all going to depend, a lot of it is going to depend on the global trade. I understand India is talking about increasing its coal productivity. If it does that, we will be less dependent on exim trade, imports of coal, and therefore exim trade will reduce. The sentiments against China, is that going to lead to reduced global trade? Possibly. This will lead to reduced revenues. This will lead to reduced things that we as ship owners and shipping companies can do. Also, will that reduce shipbuilding? Will that cause problems with reference to the modern technology that was hoped to be achieved with new ships? These are all the questions here. Talking about maritime sector, in my mind, and especially with what Mr. Hajra said earlier today, it would be completely incomplete if we did not talk about maritime education and training. Here, I would like to share with you how we have taken up this challenge and hope to continue to do so. So, as we know, schools and colleges were high risk as many other areas. And so we had to bring about quick awareness within our entire campus community and educate them and ensure that everybody was doing the right thing in terms of protecting themselves from this illness. Then came schools and colleges shut. It was very painful to send our students home. I mean, this is what they lived for, right? Being on campus. But we had to do so. We made sure they reached home safely. We keep in touch with each one of them, hoping that they remain safe of COVID-19. But the show must go on despite all odds. And of course, this is staying safe. What was equally painful is to lay down expectations from the staff that no student's education must suffer. But I must tell you that students and staff both have risen to the occasion, embracing online education, which we started very soon after the education on campus came to a grinding halt. There were some initial challenges there are some ongoing challenges. Faculty and students were in their comfort zone. They had done things for years and years together. Now we were expecting them to do things very differently. There was a new challenge. But what was interesting is they were all enthusiastic about this. And everybody got on the bandwagon, and we've had tremendous success with this. Making the timetable was a different story. I mean, we're not talking classrooms here, we're not talking practicals, not talking workshops, but we were talking online education. And you couldn't expect people to sit in front of their hardware all day long. So this was a little challenge, but we figured that out. A little challenge that still exists is the hardware that the students are carrying. Many of them are working off their phone. So this is something, when we get our opportunity, we're going to work to upgrade this. Connectivity, sometimes we in big cities have problems. So, you know, in smaller towns, clearly that's going to be an issue. We have been getting feedback from all our students. We've retrained our wardens. We have redefined their roles, and we keep in touch with them on a regular basis. In due course, I'm sure we will receive guidelines from DG Shipping and IMU, but we're going to need to sort out, how are we going to do the practicals? Are we talking virtual labs? When we will need to bring our students back for some workshop training. How are we going to do that, maintaining social distance? Are we going to bring them back in small groups? Probably that's what's going to happen. How do we do assignments? How do we do final exams? These are all things we are working on. Schools and colleges are likely to be among the last to revert to normalcy. Or are we going to have to live with a new normal? I think more likely the latter. Today we need to deal with admissions. How are we going to do our entire admission rigmarole? We would go out to schools, we would reach out to various places all over the country. We need to figure out ways to do this today online. How are we going to deliver the curriculum in the coming semesters to maybe a year or two? Examination systems, how are we going to figure that out? But more importantly, and most important in my mind today, how are we going to give our students the campus life experience? When the students come to us for 4 years, it's not just an academic education that we provide them. We make them different people from the day they come in to the day they go out. They are mature young adults, and they have grown with a wonderful campus life experience. How are we going to do this for them? At the end of the day, what is it that we want to deliver to the world? Either same quality seafarers, or if not, better. That would be our goal. Let's live smartly, let's stay safe, and thank you so much for listening.
Thank you very much, Sujata, for an absolutely excellent presentation. Of course, you have lent your voice to mine as well as so many others in the industry in thanking the ministry and the administration for whatever they have been doing. One or two very small comments. One is, you had touched upon this mental health issue of the seafarer. Now, I have been saying literally for decades that India being the land of yoga, I think we haven't propagated yoga adequately in our maritime training institute as a part of the curriculum. I had even gone to the extent of saying that India should put up a paper to IMO where yoga, if not mandatory, at least should be made recommendatory for the seafarers, because in that confined space, obviously you cannot provide too much of adequate equipments and other facilities for various kinds of exercises. Yoga is something which can really help the seafarers, not only from the physical point of view, but also from the mental point of view. Just a point I wanted to mention.
And I think we will
all take question answers last, because we are running short of time.
No, I just want to respond to you. Yeah, okay, you talked about yoga. We're already talking about doing that. We're already doing that online. Yeah.
Wonderful. Yes. So digitalization, the artificial intelligence, robotics will be the matter of everyday life, I'm quite sure. And Indian seafarers, you said they have stood by us. I'm sure that's what has happened for the Indian flag. But at times, there's absolutely no question of any criticism, because I have all the empathy for the seafarers. But there are moves like diversion of ships and all that. So there is a question mark as to whether that will be really taken in the right spirit, whether it will impact the seafarers' employment scenario for Indians in future, and things like that. Anyway, I will not get into that. Let me now request Sri Vijay Arora to be the next speaker. Sri Arora has well over 3 decades of experience in the maritime industry. He is a marine engineer by profession. And of course, as far as IRS is concerned, there are only 12 national registers, National Classification Societies, which are full-fledged member of IACS. So we as Indian, we are very proud that IACS became the full-fledged member quite a few years back through the efforts of all the people connected with the IRS, particularly my very good friend and icon, Captain J.C. Anand. And at the moment, my another good friend, Arun Sharma, who is the chairman of IRS, he also happens to be the chairman of IRS. So with this short introduction, may I request Sri Arora to deliver his speech. Unfortunately, we are running a bit short on time, so I would request both the other speakers to try and make it, if not 5 minutes, so there are about 6, 7, 8 minutes, not more than that. Mr. Arora, please. Madhavi, you have already received quite a few questions, so we'll have to answer them before the webinar is
complete. Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon to everyone. I'll be making small my observations on managing operation challenges faced due to this COVID-19 pandemic. Impact on regulatory aspects, that is decarbonization to some extent, medium and long-term impacts on maritime sector, and will pandemic accelerate digitalization and technology adoption? Well, this is a very unprecedented situation for the global shipping and industry at large, basically, maritime industry at large. The shipping industry is already reeling from an oversupply situation and is under pressure to meet with these new regulatory requirements, which are coming quite often, basically. Like first sulfur 2020 came, then we are looking for ballast water, and now we are thinking of decarbonation, basically. So we are always under pressure. And this pandemic has added an angle of uncertainty amidst this scenario. The current situation due to this outbreak of COVID-19 presents operational challenges to each and everyone in the maritime industry. Protecting the health of our colleagues and our clients while taking steps to help contain the spread of virus is our main focus. IRS remains committed to supporting our global clients with a team of surveyors who are continuing to provide services worldwide while complying with the governmental directed health and other guidelines, basically, whether operational or technical in nature, basically. As far as classification society is concerned, this business is done with a relationship. So we are in regular touch with owners, managers, flag administration of ships under these situations also. IRS has taken measures for continuing of our services while ensuring the safety of all our employees. Surveys have been provided specific guidelines to follow precautions from country-specific advisories while planning surveys, basically. The current situation due to outbreak of COVID-19 presents external challenges as well as internal challenges. Why I said external and internal? External because we are talking about which ship owners are facing, that whether they want to have an issue of dry dock, whether they have to have annual survey to postpone, whether the special service to postpone, or any other COCs or conditional class or statute notes need to be extended or dealt with. Internally also, we are facing issues because of the fact that class societies have to meet the IX requirements to remain in as a continued member. So we have to follow their procedure requirement, which are mandatory for us to follow. And in that case, we have made a task force which is working on it, so that those procedural requirements where we know that we may lapse, basically, we may not be able to do, like, let us say, a training has to be done at a periodic interval. That training cannot be done because people cannot be called. Whether e-learning can be done, whether we have requirements that theoretical training and e-learning should have a relationship. That means you cannot have more than 50% modules on e-learning. You have to have a face-to-face training also. So those issues we are working amongst IX also to see that we can deal with this current situation. Under the circumstances of pragmatic and practical approach is being adopted by IRS while rendering our services. Depending upon the specific circumstances, and if in case we are not permitted to board due to restrictions imposed by the authorities, IRS may grant survey extensions as allowed by rules and with the agreement of the flag administrations for the vessel in respect of the surveys requested, which could be, again, I say, annual survey, special survey, or any other survey, which is being considered under 4C major conditions, basically. 4C major conditions, when you talk about, mostly deal with when, let us say, owner is not able to allow us to board due to this COVID-19 situation, or we are not able to board the vessel due to lockdown where we cannot board, or it could be that the spares could not be connected, or the service team or the special team which is going to do the service suppliers are not able to board. So those are considered as a 4C major conditions. Under that, we are trying to cover present extension of surveys, basically. While flag approval, IRS is increasingly turning to use of remote surveys, adopting risk-based approach and verification of self-checks carried out by the master and chief engineer, submitting their reports with the videography or with the photographs. All these are verified by the remote surveyor, and then a recommendation sent to the flag administration whether the surveys can be extended or not. While we are working in this direction, basically we need to have a very I'll say that the approach which is acceptable to all the flag administrations and to all over the world. So IACS members also recognize that a consistency in approach between the various class societies is required, and the association has therefore established a COVID-19 task force to identify and assess measures that can be implemented in a coordinated fashions to help facilitate business continuity. IACS members have taken on unanimous stand to use each other class society server where it would be impractical for one society to attend due to travel restrictions, and a surveyor from another IACS member society could be utilized. This is definitely in subject to acceptance by the flag administration. So we need to take concurrence of the flag administration also. This measure will support the safety of the surveyor and vessel crew concerned and the broader public health and the countries concerned. Now, coming to the second part, basically, when we talk about the impact on regulatory aspects, which is decarbonization, which you talk about. Definitely, we can see that the IMO has not been working since March, and the meetings have been postponed. And even now, from 4th of May, IMO Extraordinary Council session is going on, where they are determining as to how the future meetings can take place, whether they can have face-to-face meetings or whether virtual meetings. They are going to decide, they are going to prioritize whether MEPC, MSC, and the GHG, 7th GHG group needs to meet, because the decarbonization has to come. The IMO has already adopted a strategy. Short-term measures have to come in 2023. So if in case we have to deal with this MEPC, MSC meetings needs to be done, and if in case we want the short-term measures to come at the right time, that is January 2023, we need to see that these meetings are definitely held in whatever way. Otherwise, we will have to think that there may be some delay in these short-term measures also. At the same time, I can see that all those member states who are very active for this decarbonization right now with the COVID-19 situation, it is quite possible that they may try to invest for this pandemic, this COVID-19, and maybe they'll try to delay this further work on decarbonization. Or also this ICS, who were trying to collect fund so that they can invest in R&D of these decarbonization, the zero carbon fuels. If that fund cannot be made available, there will be further delay. So those all issues will be a paramount factor to decide whether what will be the further impact on decarbonization, basically. As far as medium and long-term impact on maritime sector is concerned, today, as COVID-19 situation is there, we have been mostly working on to see that how the surveys can be extended so the ships remain in operational. Situations have been described that ballast water equipment has to fit it. You have gone to a yard, you can't do that because now in that yard doesn't allow you to come. So such situations required extension of surveys, basically certificates. We need to start thinking, and we are thinking at IACS, that whether it is that we'll have to do with the annual survey from remote, and if in case we have to deal with, how we will deal with. So that situation is being worked out. At the same time, if in case, how at in the future the remote surveys, whether it will become a new normal, we are working, we are presently having meetings on SC strategy, which is discussing on how the remote surveys can be considered as a new normal. So what parameters will be required to make it exceptional, accepted at the IMO level, basically at the flag level. So we are working on that. With respect to, will pandemic accelerate digitalization and technology adoption? I can say that whatever we have done in the past, like e-certificates, we did e-certificates, and e-certificates were being used, but not many owners were interested to use e-certificates. But at this point of time, while you know that you cannot go on board and your certs are expiring and you want to get them extended, I think this has become a new norm. And whatever we invested that time to see that the e-certs are available, we are using them. We need to see that cyber issues are addressed while we are using technology. Because even the IMO requests that cyber safety aspects should be taken into account by January 2021. For that, at least Government of India has come out with the mandatory requirement that all shipping companies by the first annual survey of January 2021 should have this cyber risk adopted. I think this situation, while we are using digitalization to a large extent, and COVID-19 situation being there, where we are using remote surveys and a lot of information is being made available to and fro, cyber aspects should be taken into account and processes should be put into place, technology will be placed, and people should be given sufficient instructions to see that this COVID situation is not impacted by this cyber issues, basically. And we are able to do our normal operations, what we have been doing. So with that, I'll say that I have been able to speak my mind, what I wanted to speak on the various subjects which were...
Thank you very much, sir, for a very, very practical presentation. I'm sure that the self-assessment, the remote surveys, all these will facilitate the shipping industry all over the world to a great extent. And coordination amongst the IATS members will be another very, very welcome move. I'm sure IMO is already meeting. They are meeting digitally. So those things are going on. And as Sujata also mentioned, I mean, you know, face-to-face meeting will become more and more rare. Most of the meetings will be all virtual meetings. Anyway, I think we are having short of time. So Sanjeev Sharma is the last but not the least speaker. He also has well over 3 decades of experience. He's a master mariner. He's also an active member of Indian Council of Arbitration as a shipping expert. He has worked in Japan. He has worked in Singapore. And he has been with Bernard Silke since 2013 and took over as the managing director in 2015. So I hand over the floor to Captain Sanjeev Sharma.
So, first of all, thank you very much, Mr. Hajara, and good afternoon to everybody once again. First of all, let me thank IRS, Informa, and IMEX for inviting me and be part of this distinguished panel. Much has been said already, I think, and I'm the last speaker, so I will try not to repeat what is already being put into this forum. First of all, I am the managing director of Bernard Schulte Ship Management, which is a fully owned subsidiary of Bernard Schulte Group. Bernard Schulte Group is a 135-year-old shipping group, and we call ourselves to be integrated maritime solution provider. Basically, we can offer all kinds of services right from the conceptualization or the design of the vessel to when the ship is entering into demolition. And so being such an old group, 135-year-old, so the group has seen two world wars, the great earlier Great Depression of 1920, and many other upheavals what shipping industry has seen during this time. And every time the group has survived and has come stronger. So we are currently also ship owner as well as the ship managers. So at this moment we have over 600 ships, 18,000 seafarers belonging to 23 or 24 nationalities. And they are all managed by a network of about 11 ship management center and 24 crew service center all over the world. So it's a large setup. So to manage this large setup, we already have a very in-house, strongly developed ERP system. We own a IT company in-house, so all our IT solutions are developed in-house. So frankly, we already always had this business continuity plan, which we were always exercising every year, and it came very handy. So when lockdown was announced progressively in different countries, it started with China, where we have an office in Hong Kong and other places. So the adapting to the working from home or not working from office was absolutely seamless. And we were talking about Dr. Naik was saying that we should not have any paper. Even DG was emphasizing onto it. I can inform you that almost 99% we are working digitally. All of our data, and it can be exchanged and can be seen and can also be processed through various tools among all our offices. So it's a lot of intelligence which we have. So so working from home, absolutely no challenge, and the operations remains almost seamless. Of course, the biggest problem as the lockdown spread all over the world, some places even our superintendents got stuck here and there. But fortunately, in the nick of the time, we could bring them back. But the crew change has become a big challenge. In spite of that, there are certain countries, even in North Europe or in China for the Chinese crew, or in India, we are very, very thankful to DG and the Ministry of Home Affairs that they came out very quickly about allowing the crew change in India. So many of our ships who were calling to India, there were a few who were diverted to India to do the crew change. And we were able to do. And as I am talking, maybe tomorrow we are again having another crew change in Kandla. But that is still our big challenge, because we have more than 5,000 seafarers who have completed their contracts and they are still remaining on board. And much is talked about that it is a lot of anxiety has crept into their minds. But the important thing, which very early we realize, is to talk to the seafarers, call the ships as often as we can, and better, because there is today, because of the social media, a lot of such news is flashed which creates more anxiety among people, that what is happening to my family member and all. So more than their own contract being increased, I think we realized they were more worried about what is happening to their near and dear ones in the countries or in their homes. So we allowed them to have more data where they can be in touch. Because most of our ships are equipped with the VSAT or other such equipment where our seafarers are usually allowed a lot of free data so that they can be in touch with their home family member. And that has cooled down a bit. I would say, of course, it is a challenge, but by and large, our seafarers have been extremely cooperative. And I think more because we were always maintaining this touch with them. And barring a few incident which can be, we can ignore, or maybe we were able to control. Most of our seafarers were very understanding. They understood that at this moment, ship is much more safer than coming ashore, because during the transit also they can catch this infection. And especially in early days, it was not much was known to it. So all in all, the situation is under control, but I don't know how long. And I wish that we are coming towards this lockdown age. And as Mr. Amitabh started that, it is nowhere that we would say that there will be no COVID after this. Of course, this is post-lockdown. And I think every situation, every such situation, it's almost like a war-like situation where the whole world is impacted. And there is always, when it is hit, it is like a shock. We don't know what to do, and we take some preemptive actions. And then there is a period when the acceptance comes, and then we start adapting it, and we start controlling the situation. I have a strong feeling that the world has reached a stage when the acceptance has absolutely crept in. And now we also know that slowly how we can control it and live our normal lives further with it. And we are seeing more and more countries a little bit becoming relaxed. So hopefully things will improve from here. So coming to the next one, the impact on the regulations, we feel, I don't know what does it mean? It was about the implementation of the new regulations or compliance with the existing things. But I feel by and large, it has not impacted much. I think it is continuing. There are a few here and there, some problems where we could not arrange some audits or inspections, but CLAS and FLAG have been absolutely very understanding, and they were very quick to make decisions that sometime extensions were given or sometime a few times the remote audits were allowed. In fact, for our own, because we are into ship management side, we have to constantly do audits and the inspection of the vessels. We also devised a protocol by which ship staff can participate and do, and it became elaborate, and suppose somebody sitting ashore, superintendent, and communicating with different departmental head on board the ship and guiding them with photographs and everything, that how to inspect and how to give back the report so that it is also not neglected. And second aspect being, we are into services side, so maintaining a good contact with the customer was also very important, because we have to travel and meeting them and having regular meetings with them. So technology has helped here also, and I think even most of the customers were also quite forthcoming too. But they are also not interested that many people should come to their office now. So we are having online meetings, and they are also quite productive. In fact, it is a frankly, it is more productive. Sometimes it is to the point, and you don't waste. You know, normally in a normal meeting, even within the office, or even we waste a lot of time with the. They are not very.
Sanjeev, if you don't mind, you'll have to kindly wrap up your presentation, because there are so many questions. I know you may not be able to okay. call, but at least a couple of them I would like.
Okay. Absolutely, no. I will take this something about the shipping that is still running, and I feel the shipping is essentially a thermometer of international trade. So presently the trade is down because most of the industries, because of this lockdown, are not working. There is not a movement, but I am not very pessimistic that the situation will remain even in medium term like this. As lockdowns will become really better, and then the industries will come back to it. I think in medium term to long term, the shipping should pick up. And I think the human race is very resilient. Such situations have come and gone, and then they always devise new ways to, you know, get over it. And just the last one, I just want to add quickly, is about the digitalization. Definitely, there is now something is very positive which has come out of this COVID-19 thing, is that one is, of course, the environment has become better, I would say. Mm-hmm. And secondly, is that it has opened the eyes for the impact what digitalization can bring. Especially shipping industry, which is very, very conservative as far as adapting the technology is concerned. They always, most of the people are just sitting on the fence. And change the situation, probably I wish that people will be more open to embrace technology. And there are a lot of things which I feel will happen in the short to long term. Is that remote monitoring and ship movement, because I think the bandwidth on the ships are increasing. There will be live, there are solutions already available and which will become more and more prevalent, is about the live assistance in solving the problems on board, technical problem especially, you know, connecting with the ship. Of course, remote audits and inspection, and these are becoming quite common and slowly picking up. And one very important thing is the better record keeping because of this digitalization, which sometimes missed out, which are very, very important. And of course, the environmental monitoring. We have a lot of solutions which we have implemented on our board, our ships, to remotely monitor the environment. So I'll wrap up because there is not much time. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Sanjeev. Actually, we have quite a few questions. I don't know, we are already at 4:30. I hope that we manage to get another 10-15 minutes. So the first question is India, right? This is something I touched upon. Mr. Ramesh Upadhyay has asked, is Indian shipbuilding likely to gain from this pandemic? And there is a related question raised also that whether this anti-China sentiment will benefit India in any way. I'll direct this question to Mr. Arora. Mr. Arora, if you could please quickly try to give an answer.
Mike, I think this is a very good opportunity for maritime community and maritime sector to come up, because we have been trying to move the trade from road to water transport, and we have been working last 5 years. We came up with lot of designs, approved designs. We came out with lot of rules with respect to methanol fuel ships, LNG fuel ships, coastal vessels, inland vessels, what type of design, shallow draft vessels. I think right now when we are thinking of Make in India and we are thinking of this COVID-19 situation, where we should try to take this situation in a positive way, we may have to bring in some discipline amongst the yards, bring them some technology to see that they are able to implement. I always try to think that if Maruti could come to our country and could bring so many good cars, we can also have some sector which starts making, which may be a government sector, which has taken alliance with some other foreign yards, brings the culture, and we are able to implement it so that the shipping comes in this country. It may require some ancillary units also, so that we are able to provide the equipments immediately on time. With this thinking in mind, I think this is the best time to think about bringing shipping in our country, basically, whether it is repair or new construction, both.
Mr. Azra, can I just add one line on this one?
Yeah, please.
You see, there is a 20 lakh crore package has been declared for this thing. Not a mention of maritime industry.
Actually, Sanjeev, there is a specific. Sorry to interrupt. There is a specific question on that.
Just one line. They talked about making India for the maintenance hub for the airlines industry. And I think in India, Dr. Naik was telling us that she took her ship to dry dock in China. And that's the reality. And why can't we make the repair hub in India?
In this regard, I'll add that Ministry of Shipping is working on Vision 2030. There have been subgroups formed where ports, shipping, training, so many six sectors have been identified, and we are working on that with subgroups. I think DG Shipping will be knowing about this basically more on a larger scale. So it is happening basically from the point that we have started working on this issue basically, I'll say.
And also shipping is still a very human intensive business, and I don't know what it is.
I would seek the indulgence of Amitav. If you could just jot down, because next three questions are all basically, you are the best person to answer. The first question from what Mr. Anand Upadhyay is about this, I'll just read out the question. Does the recently announced government financial package include any announcements for shipping industry? That is question number one. The question number two, I think there are other Mr. Ashutosh Tripathi and Mr. Nandini Savan. I'll just also put those questions. They are different questions, but since he will be replying, I'm putting all these questions together. Next question is, many officers who have cleared their chief mate license and applied for COC, but applications pending due to pandemic, how is DG Shipping addressing this? This is the next question. Then there is another question. That is, are there possibilities of change in rules and regulations for selecting and sending candidates on board? And finally, are we considering reductions in human interactions at Indian ports? This, of course, anyone could answer, but since you are answering, I request you to also touch upon this point. Mehtabji, if you could kindly take these questions.
I would take that the shipbuilding question has been answered.
Please.
As for MSME, one major announcement that was made was to equate MSME in manufacturing sector and MSME in service sector. That means that all the advantages of MSME's schemes automatically get extended to the shipping industry also. Only issue with shipping industry is that it is a capital intensive industry. And because of the intensive capital investment, not many large shipping companies would be designated as MSME. But so far as small players are concerned, especially in offshore sector and coastal shipping sector, inland shipping may utilize the benefits of MSME schemes in shipping industry also. In fact, last week only I have requested Mr. Anil Devli, CEO of INSA, to organize a webinar with all the shipping, with the entire shipping community on the benefits that the Indian shipping industry can utilize from the present announcement of the government. Of course, the present announcement is more in terms of loans and extra liquidity that can be put in the hands of MSME. But hopefully in the coming week, either this week or in the coming week, we will have a seminar with experts in MSME to discuss what kinds of benefits can be utilized by the shipping industry from present announcements. There is also a scheme of one of the public sector banks, which ensures the loans taken by MSMEs. And once this loan is insured, then you don't have to put any collateral against that loan. We would discuss that scheme also in, I think it is IDBI scheme. We would discuss this particular scheme also, whether it would be of any use for small ship owners. Now, let's come to COC. That is the second question. We had some discussions. COC, as you know, there are COCs for MEO class 4, which is used by a different e-governance system that we have for online examination. And then there is COC for class 2 and chief engineers. The COC for class 2 and chief engineer is prepared by DG Shipping itself. I have already directed the chief examiner to upload all these COCs on the master checker. So maybe in the weeks to come, because physical delivery of COC is not possible because the Indian Post is not working and we are not encouraging any person to travel all the way to MMD's or DGS office to collect physical copy of COCs. But all these COCs would be available on the master checker and a digital copy will be available with the seafarers and they can take a job based digital copy that is available with them. Then there is the third...
I'm sorry, but the question was specifically to chief mate.
Same thing will be done for chief mate.
Okay. That was specific. That's why I thought I was listening.
The third question, I did not understand the possibility of change in rules and regulations. Which particular rule and regulation they are talking about. But if any of our existing rule is creating any hindrance in terms of job opportunities for an Indian seafarer, we would definitely like to have a relook at our rules and regulations. Rules and regulations are framed by the administration itself, and there is no reason as to why a relook cannot be taken on these rules and regulations. As Dr. Sujata Nayak had mentioned, many of these things are temporary measures that have been put in place to deal with COVID situation. COVID situation is itself dynamic, and so is our guideline. We are revising it almost on day-to-day basis, depending on the issues that are being faced. If there is any specific issue, do let us know and we will have a look into it. As regards the long-term policy on reduction of in interaction at ports, for short-term, of course, we have come up with a DGS order, which deals in detail with the ship-to-port interaction, the roles that various parties are to play, whether it is PHO, whether it is harbor master, whether it is pilot, the ship's crew, the staff, the labor that is to board a ship for cargo operation. So that particular aspect has been covered for short-term basis. But what we are discussing today is in the long-term to have completely contactless port calls by the ships on Indian ports. There are two major schemes that are already in various stages of implementation. One relates to the port. IPA is implementing that scheme. It deals with all the ships' requirements for port calls, whether commercial or technical. This will be done through an online system. The second is our DG's e-governance system, which also is aimed towards finishing any kind of human interaction at DG's office. So all interaction that the DG or any of its office will have with any of its stakeholders, be it the seafarer or the ship owner or the MTIs or the RPS or DG approved doctors, these will be completely online with no paper transaction required for any of the interactions. So between these two, I would say midterm projects that are already underway, I am sure that 99% of our port and shipping related requirements or the services that the ports and shipping are to provide to the stakeholders will be carried out online, and there will be no requirement for any human interaction.
Wonderful. I think we must all congratulate you for making DGS almost pitfall free. It's a great endeavor. There are more questions. I don't know till what time we are allowed to go on, but I'll take just a couple of more questions. One is from Mr. Praveen Mishra, and just for the exigencies of time, I will just give a short answer. The question is, what will be the impact of COVID-19 on investments in reduction of GHG emissions? Now, as I am sure we are all aware, these regulations time frame is 2030, 2050, so on and so forth. So there could be, because of the COVID-19 impact, obviously, the entire shipping industry, the shipbuilding industry, all maritime related industry will have tremendous shortages of cash for investment. So the investments could get impacted, at least in the short term. I don't think it will be even medium term. So I don't think that the reduction of GHG emissions, the goalposts that have been set by IMO really need to be changed, at least for the time being. I mean, if the COVID-19 continues as it is continuing for another 2 years, then nobody knows what will happen. But as it stands today, I am not directing this question to anyone, because I think no one will be able to give any clearer picture than what it is available now. The next question, where it could be put to both Sujata and Amitav ji, I will just put first to Sujata. It says, what changes are required in maritime education system as shipping is becoming more and more digitalized?
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, you can all hear me.
First of all, from the administration's office already, there's a lot of e-learning which has been put into place. But we are now talking about our entire curriculum becoming digitalized. And I think that is really the way to go. I think we need to be able to conduct as much as possible by digital, digitized methods and digital learning. Even to the extent that we may be able to create virtual labs, but there may be a few things and a good number of things that one is not going to be able to do. And for that, we will have to have our hands-on experience. And for that, people would need to be, in an academic environment, in a workshop environment. So I don't know if that is answering the question. I don't know if that answered the question.
Yes, I think it does. Yeah, In case Amita wants to supplement anything, he is most welcome to do that.
See, I agree. There are 3-4 methods that we, even before COVID, we were moving in that direction. One, of course, was e-learning. E-learning gives us a very standardized content for all the maritime institutes to follow. The second is absence of classroom requirement. We have already come up with a circular yesterday allowing virtual classes to be taken in place of theory classes. The third requirement will be of practicals. The practicals, there are two possible solutions. One solution is, of course, whatever we can move towards whatever virtual or online systems are available. Airline industry is doing it for a fairly long time. Somehow shipping industry has not adapted the simulators as much as the airline industry has. So whatever can be done through simulation, even in practical courses, can be shifted to simulation. But ultimately, some amount of hands-on training will be required. For hands-on training, the batches need to be subdivided at least into 4 subgroups. These batches get divided into 4 subgroups, then as per our present understanding, the social distancing requirements of the government can be met and hands-on training can be provided from the present infrastructure that has been created by the maritime training institutes. We have just started the virtual learning. We will now sit back to the drawing board to see what we need to do for practical trainings and whatever best solutions are possible. Given the present constraints, we would come up with those solutions in next 10 to 15 days time.
Thank you very much. I'm told by the organizers that we have a hard stop in next 3-4 minutes. So there are more questions. I'm told that there were registration of 850 persons for this particular webinar, which I think is possibly could be a record for the maritime webinars done till date. So that's very encouraging. I must once again, from the core of my heart, thank all the speakers for their tremendous contribution. And there are, as I said, a few more questions. My personal apologies to those who had raised those questions. I would request them to send it to the, I think they are already in the chat. I would encourage the organizers to direct them to the relevant speakers so that the person who has raised the question can also be answered. So with this, I would, I can see, sorry.
Sahaja, can I just, I kind of missed on something which I really do want to touch upon, because Captain Sanjeev Sharma also mentioned it, and I want to say a few words about it, because I think this was also a very important piece that he covered, and this is something that we also got a lot of positive results from, ourselves. The whole working from home experience for us has been wonderful, in terms of having our IT structures in place. Most importantly, the reason that our seafarers today are able to do what they are able to do is because of the robust systems in the office to provide support to our seafarers at all times, talking to them frequently, and keeping them assured. This has been very, very pivotal. And this is, as Captain Sanjeev Sharma described, this has been very pivotal in ensuring that our seafarers have been at ease and have been able to continue to function in the way they have. This was the entire support system from the office has been stellar, and I'm sure that has been the case at BSM also. And I think that's what makes the whole clock tick. So I just wanted to add.
Of course, Sujata, as they say in almost any industry, communication is the key.
Right.
Without communication, as it is also said, of course, in a different way, that there is no problem in the world which should not be able to be resolved through dialogue.
Yes.
There is the communication and dialogue, which is the most important thing. I can see Jogesh back here, though he is muted. So unless the organizers have anything to say, then from my side, I once again thank everyone. Of course, I've already thanked the speakers. I thank everyone present in the webinar. And I will now request the organizers to say anything if required. Otherwise, we can conclude the webinar.
Yeah. Thank you. I've been on this webinar all the while. I just shut down my video for a bit because of handling certain other things. But pleasure to see this webinar. And I'm sure this is just the first of the series of webinars that we are hosting on behalf of Informex and InfoMarkets, and definitely we'll want to do a lot more. So many, I think, as you said, it's a record number of attendees and registrations that we have got. I'm sure this will only instill more and more dialogues. And I think, as Madam Naik said, that I think we should use technology more and more for this. And pleasure to have the who's who of industry. I think thank you so much, sirs, and for your valuable advice. And we'll continue. And Mr. Hajra, thank you so much for being such a generous moderator and kind, and such a enlightened moderator. I think I must say, with your experience and vision for the industry. So thank you again, and look forward to continuing.